Yeah. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Faith Bible Baptist Fellowship this morning. We are going to stand and sing a well-known hymn, How Great Thou Art. Sing right up, please.
Oh, Lord, my God.
Sing my soul, my Savior.
Thank you. You may be seated.
Amen. Thank you, Gary. You're sounding lovely today, this Thanksgiving weekend. I just want to draw your attention just to a few announcements. We could just put up on the board the announcement about the wedding shower. There will be a wedding shower hosted here in the church gym on Saturday, October 24th from 2 to 4 p.m. for Spencer Tapley and Lily Crow, our own Lily Crow. This is a COVID-style shower, so no, please drop by with your gifts and have a short visit. Mask and social distancing are required. Let's be the encouragement we need to be for the young couples as they begin their journey together. So, and just for your information, Lily and Spencer are registered at the following places: Walmart, Bed Bath & Beyond, and on Amazon. So we hope to see a good number out on Saturday, October the 24th. Again, we want to draw your attention to our coming in the month of November. Reserve the dates in the evening services for November 1st, where Don and Lorraine Nickerson, who are missionaries in Japan, will be updating us and sharing from the Word of God on November 1st in the evening service. On November 8th in the evening service at 6 p.m., Gary and Christina Long, who are One Hope Missionary Canada's, One Hope Canada missionaries, camp directors at Sandy Cove Bible Camp in Dumfries, New Brunswick, and on Davidson Lake, are going to be sharing with us in the evening service and giving us an update and then sharing from the Word of God. And on November the 15th in the evening service at 6 p.m., David and Susan Smith, who are Assist Canada missionaries here in the Maritimes and our own members of our congregation here, are going to be sharing and giving a brief message from the Word of God. And then on November 29th, Dr. Lindsay Taylor, a retired pastor, is going to be sharing from the Word of God Sunday morning and Sunday evening, and that is going to be our Faith Promise Sunday. So be in prayer for these meetings and for what God would have you promise for missions in 2012. I also want to read to you a news release. Masks mandatory in indoor public places. Exposure notification. Changes to travel restrictions at Quebec border. So this is dated October the 8th. The provincial government announced today, October the 8th, that masks will become mandatory in most indoor public places effective at midnight tonight. Based upon what we are seeing in our neighboring provinces and the outbreak in Moncton, we know how quickly the virus can spread through a community, said Premier Blaine Higgs. We must make every possible measure to prevent that from happening in our province. Masks will become mandatory in most indoor places. This includes public spaces where the public and employees interact, retail businesses, malls, services centers, places of worship, restaurants and bars, etc., while eating. An organized indoor gatherings in public places, i.e. weddings and funerals, etc. Common areas like lobbies, elevators and hallways, and public shared spaces, including those in private sector and government workspaces, and on public transportation. Continuous mask use is still required in seated venues with one meter physical distancing. Now, what does that mean? That means when you come to the church and you're mingling around, wear a mask. When you're seated and socially distancing from 2 meters from somebody, you don't have to wear your mask, okay? So that means while you're here worshiping together, you don't have to wear your mask as long as you are 2 meters away, 6 feet or four chairs from somebody who is not inside of your bubble, okay? And we are making a list of bubble people, so if you are part of a bubble group, we would like to know what your bubble group is. That way we can have a list, and if anybody has any questions, we can say, no, they are in that bubble. And so we're taking bubble lists, but you must be two meters from anyone not inside your bubble. And if that be the case, then you don't have to wear a mask. If you are within 2 meters of somebody not in your bubble, then you do need to wear a mask, okay? So mingling around and leaving the services, you need to wear a mask, but once you're in and seated and social distancing, practicing social distancing, and I think everybody does that, then we don't have to wear our masks. So just for your information. Now, I think that's all the announcements that I have at this time. So Jared, why don't you come and rescue us and open us up the Word of God.
Good morning. I'd ask that you would stand with me if you could and turn to Romans chapter 8. We'll finish off the chapter, so from verses 18 to 39. And we'll do some responsive reading this morning, so I'll read a verse and then you guys read a verse and then I'll read a verse and on until the end of the chapter there. So Romans chapter 8, starting in verse 18. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. For the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who hath subjected the same in hope.
Because the creature itself shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God.
For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now.
And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body.
For we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man seeth, why doth he yet hope for?
But if we hope for that we see not, then do we with patience wait for it.
Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities. For we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered.
And he that searcheth the heart knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God.
And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose.
For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren.
Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called, and whom he called, them he also justified, and whom he justified, them he also glorified.
What shall we say then to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us?
He that spared not his own Son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things?
Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifies.
Who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather, that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us.
Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword?
As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long, we are counted as sheep for the slaughter.
Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us.
For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come,
nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Amen. May God bless the reading of his word.
Remain standing for a word of prayer, please. Dear God, we say thank you for this morning. Thank you for this opportunity that we have to meet together here. We say thank you for the opportunity that we have to meet together via the radio and also various internet connections. And dear Lord, we pray that we would be challenged this morning, that we would be encouraged, that we would truly worship you as we look to you to give you honor. And we'll say thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Please take your hymn books as we remain standing to sing these next two, especially because you need some extra air in your lungs, and that's done best while you're standing. Number 8, To God Be the Glory.
For sin, and hope, and the light, faith, and all make a way.
singing this morning. Now, something that we saw at Kingsley Baptist Church last week. Now, we haven't been able to shake hands and greet one another for quite some time. And when we were visiting there last Sunday morning, they had the greeting wave. And so let's do that this morning. Make sure you wave to people, greet them this morning. We can't shake their hands. We can't mingle around without our mask. So don't forget that we still need to greet one another.
Yes, we do.
I sing the mighty power of God. It's easier to get you back in your seats and get to move to the next song this way, though.
I sing the mighty power of God that made the mountains rise, that spread the flowing seas abroad and filled the lofty skies. I sing the wisdom that ordained the sun to rule the day, the moon shines full.
We're going to sing a few choruses at this time. I have one announcement, a reminder of the youth group campfire tonight at the Long's house in Sussex Corner. Of course, that's going to be outside. The best bonfires are outside. And it almost felt a little bit like the other morning, though. I should start a fire in the stove, but not quite time yet. So just a reminder, that's for middle school, high school students and leaders, and, you know, we're not going to shoo anybody away. Two things to bring, a snack or a sweet to share, and we'll be serving those. You bring them and we'll serve them, and bring a lawn chair, if you would like. We only have so many logs, and so if you don't want to sit on the grass, which will probably be pretty damp by that time, at 7:30 after church, at 7:30, 1127 Main. So, hope to see you tonight. There is a Redeemer.
Thank you, O my.
Don't forget to at least tell your eyes, okay? I know it's hard to smile when you sing, but from the cheeks up, right? From the cheeks up. He has made me glad. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will pray as the pastor comes. Dear God, we say thank you for the fact that we can sing praises this morning to you, that no matter what is going on in the world, we can look to you in the midst of a storm. And as I sat at my sun porch last night and watched the lightning and listened to the thunder, and as it even shook the windows at times, you are greater than that lightning, and you are greater than that thunder, so, because you created them. You are greater, and this is mind-boggling, than for us as humans. You are greater than the universe, but you love us, and you came and you died on the cross for us, and you rose again and 3 days later, just like the scriptures said you would. And we say thank you that we have the opportunity to trust in you as our Savior. Thank you that we can worship you this morning and get to know you better, no matter where we are, whether we're in this room or around the world. We say thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Pastor.
Thank you, Gary, and thank you, Jared, and thank you, Teresa, for a lovely piano playing. I really appreciate your ministry. Take your Bibles, please, and turn to the book of Psalm 118 this morning. And while you're turning to Psalm 118, there is an announcement I forgot to make. And Wendy, I'm looking for you for clarification on this. Just on this Thursday, at beginning around 2 o'clock, we're going to be starting up our WANA program for children ages pre-kindergarten, so that's before and five, before kindergarten, and right straight through to grade 5. Is that correct, Wendy? Grade 5. Yes, and they need to let us know what's going on. There are some protocols that have to take place, so if you have any questions or want your children to come there, they need to register because we need to take you through the rules and regulations to follow for the COVID regulations. And so bear that in mind. So let us know if you're planning on having your children come. Now, if they go to Sussex Elementary School, we will be providing a service whereby we will be walking them after school from the elementary school to the church with social distancing rules following as well and applying. But we need to know who is coming. So if you have a young person who's in Sussex Elementary School who's planning on coming or would like to come to the Awana program, then again, you need to call us and let us know that they are coming, their name and their age and what grade they're in, so that we can make sure that we have the proper amount of leadership as well. Also, to just sort of bear in mind, you'll notice that in the front of the church when you walked in the double doors, we are providing some masks. If you're being uncomfortable and feel like you want to wear a mask, then we're going to provide some masks. If you came this morning and or don't have any masks, there's some masks there for social distancing purposes. And so please avail yourself of those masks. Well, we're not here today to talk about masks. We're not here today to talk about all the problems that COVID-19 pandemic is creating in our lives. We're not here to talk about whether you're for it or against it. We're here to talk about the Word of God. It's all about the Lord Jesus Christ today. And that's what we want to dedicate our hour to. And so if you have your Bibles, take them and open them up to Psalm 118. Psalm 118 says, "Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, because his mercy endureth forever. Let Israel now say that his mercy endureth forever. Let the house of Aaron now say that his mercy endureth forever. Let them now that fear the Lord," that's you and I, "say that his mercy endureth forever. I called upon the Lord in distress, and the Lord answered me and set me in a large place. The Lord is on my side. I will not fear. What can COVID-19 do unto me? The Lord taketh my part with them that help me. Therefore shall I see my desire upon them that hate me. It is better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man." I want to pause there for a second and remind you that verse, I am told, is the central verse of the entire Bible. So at the center of the entire Bible is about trusting in the Lord. What's the main thought that God wants you to know? To trust in him. It is better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man. It is better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in princes. All nations compass me about, but in the name of the Lord will I destroy them. They compass me about, yea, they compass me about, but in the name of the Lord I will destroy them. They compass me about like bees. They are quenched as a fire of thorns, for in the name of the Lord I will destroy them. Thou hast thrust sore at me that I might fall, but the Lord helped me. The Lord is my strength and my song, and has become my salvation. The voice of rejoicing and salvation is in the tabernacles of the righteous. The right hand of the Lord doeth valiantly. The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord doeth valiantly. I shall not die, but live and declare the works of the Lord. The Lord has chastened me sore, but he has not given me over unto death. Open to me the gates of righteousness. I will go into them, and I will praise the Lord. This gate of the Lord into which the righteous shall enter, I will praise thee, for thou hast heard me and art become my salvation. The stone which the builders refused has become the head of the stone of the corner. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day which the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Save now, I beseech thee, O Lord. O Lord, I beseech thee, send now prosperity. Blessed be he that cometh in the name of the Lord. We have blessed you out of the house of the Lord. God is the Lord, which hath showed us light. Bind the sacrifice with cords, even unto the horns of the altar. Thou art my God. I will praise thee. Thou art my God. I will exalt thee. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. For his mercy endureth forever. And then turning over one more passage of Scripture, the book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 18. You'll notice that Psalm 118 starts and begins the same way. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever. The whole psalm is encapsulated about giving thanks to God for all the things that he has done, for who he is, what he has done, and what he can do. And in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 18, we have the command right from the Apostle Paul, who was led by the Spirit to write, "In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you." This is Thanksgiving Day weekend, and we want to celebrate and find ways to give thanks to our God. By the way, for those who will be coming back to the evening service, and we hope that you will find time to come back in the evening service at 6 p.m., we're going to be having an opportunity where you can express thanks to God for the goodness that he's done to you. Maybe you want to thank the Lord for saving your soul, thank the Lord for making you whole, thank the Lord for giving to you his great salvation so rich and free. We're going to have a time of giving thanks tonight and singing and praising and then looking into the Word of God. But this morning I want to talk about thankful for my God. And I want to begin by reading to you some excerpts of a message I came across this past week on the heartbreaking sin of ingratitude. Listen to some thoughts. Gratitude is not a spiritual or moral dessert which we may take or push away according to the whims of the moment, and in either case without material consequences. Gratitude is the very bread and meat of spiritual and moral health, individually and collectively. Let me read that opening statement to you again. Gratitude is not a spiritual or moral dessert which we may take or push away according to the whims of the moment, and in either case without material consequences. Gratitude is the very bread and meat of spiritual and moral health, individually and collectively. Gratitude is not a general virtue floating around on the periphery of the personality. Gratitude is central, basic, decisive. The success, continuity, and climax of individuals and nations are determined by the sovereignty of God, and gratitude is the determining factor with that sovereignty. What was the seed of disintegration that corrupted the heart of the ancient world beyond the point of divine remedy, where God gave it up to wallow in its filth, where men and women became foul with unnatural lusts and perversions, where not a fresh breath of purity blew through the heavenly atmosphere of its stench? What was it but ingratitude? When they knew God, they glorified him not as God, and neither were thankful. What was it but ingratitude when they, what was it that blinded with pride the eyes of the young man of the far distant time, dethroned him from his seat of authority and dignity, and led him a bound slave from the wealth and comforts of his father's house to the hog pen? What was it that led him from the music of the voices of a father and mother and sister and brother to the hard, cold, barren ground of the faraway country where only swine grunted and fugitive winds wailed their distress? What was it that tore from his back his woven robe, jerked from his feet his shoes of freedom, and pulled from his finger the signet of love, and left his shivering form of the mercy of such tattered rags as he could find? Was it but ingratitude? When he knew his father, he praised him not as his father, neither was he thankful. The first step of civilization toward disaster and the first step of an individual toward disaster are one and the same, that of ingratitude. Ingratitude is the basic sin of the world. It is the basic sin of youth. It is the basic sin of middle age. Such gratitude as most middle-aged people have drains into the belly. A girdle will improve the figure, but it won't change the heart. Old age, with those rare and beautiful exceptions, finds little for which to be thankful. A deep and genuine sense of gratitude is as foreign to our daily routine as to pigs leisurely rooting around in the orchard. We have about the same sense of appreciation for bread on the table as they have for the apples on the ground. Like the ox in the stall, we take everything without a sense of wonder, appreciation, and thanksgiving. Without wonder at the cause behind everything, without appreciation that God not only flings constellations and systems into infinite space and knows each star by name, but that same God gives the ravens its meat in due season and looks with pity on sparrows that fall. Without thanksgiving that we, unlike the winged creatures of the heavens and four-footed beasts of the field, were conceived and fashioned in his infinite intelligence and born of his infinite love and have engraven upon us his very image. The gratitude that most men have for their wives is like a claw hammer coat for special occasions. There was a time when she to him was dear and sweet, gentle, kind, and good. There was a wonderful mystery in her personality, like the glow hovering above the mountain range as the day fades. Her love for him troubled all that was good and kind and pure in him and brought it to the surface. Every lovely thing his eyes saw and every tender note his ears heard reminded him of her. Every breath he drew was a breath of thanksgiving to God that he had fashioned her and breathed into her being all her excellencies and that he had given her to him. He was a thankful creature in those young and fresh and happy days. But now that he has her, she takes her place among the electric stove, the refrigerator, the radio, television, and other utilities. And to a lot of wives, a hard-working, honest, loyal, sober husband coming home at night is just as much to be thankful for as the coal the truckman is shoveling into the bin. You need coal, and you need a husband. You have both. Both are routine. Neither is anything for special Thanksgiving. You should visit some of your sisters and see the hot tears flow down their faces. They tell you how the drunken husband has beaten the children. You will find plenty of them. You'll find plenty of women in great and tragic distress because their son-in-law comes home at least once a week and beats up their daughter. And of course, children are lacking in gratitude for their parents. The chief reason why all of us are so lacking in genuine daily gratitude is that we are so sheep-headed and dumb. We are lacking in intelligence and understanding. We know the scriptures, but we don't understand them. We know everything in general and understand nothing in particular. When David spoke of nature, a river of praise flowed from his mouth to God. Bless the Lord, O my soul, he said, when David was thinking of nature. He knew that nature was the handiwork of the personal God. He knew that nature was a personal as a priceless work of art from a master's hand. He knew that there was thought and design and purpose behind every hue of color, behind every flaming world, every bud and every violet. The clouds were the chariot of the Almighty, and the winds were the wings upon which he walked. Everything was designed by God. For what is nature? It is the handiwork of God, every stroke of it. What is the life of nature? It is the breath of God. How can a man live in a world like this without praising God and giving thanks unto him with every breath he draws? What a degrading sin it is to live in a world like this without the heart constantly reaching up to God in thanksgiving and praise. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever. And in everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Today, I want to give you a list of things to help you to give thanks. The list revolves around how our great and mighty God has revealed himself to us. The idea for this message flows out of our study of the book of Revelation. For in chapter 1 alone, Jesus reinforces the truths about himself several times and in different ways. It truly is the book of Revelation, the revelation of Jesus Christ. As I was contemplating, and I had fully planned and prepared on preaching, continuing our message on the book of Revelation, but as I began to reach and to appreciate how Jesus Christ keeps revealing himself to me, I began to understand I can be thankful for God, how God has revealed himself to me. Now, I wish that we had time to spend hours upon hours to go through the Word of God from Genesis to the book of Revelation and just see how God has revealed himself to us in ways that we need at the moment we need them. But we don't have that kind of time. But what I am going to ask is that we turn to the book of Genesis. And what we're going to do is we're going to see how God has revealed himself in various ways in the book of Revelation. And I have 8 points. So we're going to cover 8 things quickly to give thanks to God for how he has revealed himself only in the book of Genesis. Now again, this is the opening book. But God reveals himself in so many ways. When Jesus said, I am that I am, he's telling us I am the God who reveals himself constantly to us. The ever-present, the ever-existing one. And so all we have time for is just really quickly to see how God has revealed himself to us in Genesis chapter 1. In Genesis chapter 1, we have simply this, for which I'm thankful for. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and the darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light, and there was light. You'll notice the opening phrase there says, in the beginning, God. That's the Elohim. El meaning mighty, and him being plural. Okay, so there's a uniplural God, and he's a mighty God. And that tells me, as I learn and look at Genesis chapter 1, I am thankful today that my God is a powerful God. in the opening verse of the opening chapter of the Bible, God wants you to know that he is here, he is existent, and he is a powerful God. He spoke, and things came into existence. Now, if our God has that kind of power, and by the way, when you get into Revelation chapter 1, it says that Jesus Christ is the Almighty God, the Almighty. If that kind of power exists within our Savior, if that kind of power exists within our God, then there is nothing that you're going to face. There is nothing that I'm going to face that is too big for my God. My God is a powerful God, and he's able to subdue all our enemies. The psalmist said in Psalm 118 today that I was surrounded by an army, but you defeated them. Nothing is too big. Nothing is beyond his strength. God speaks and things happen. I am thankful today that we have a God. And listen to me, my friends, no matter how barren, no matter how desperate, no matter how bad your situation may appear, you, if you know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, if you're walking in fellowship and in hand with our God, you have a powerful God who's able to deliver you. And you may not have much to give thanks for, but you can say, today I can give thanks that my God is bigger than my problem. Listen to me, my friends. Your God, if you know Jesus Christ is your personal Savior, your God is bigger than your problem, and he's able to deliver you. We have a powerful God. He spoke, and things happened. Now, something else flows out of this passage of Scripture in Genesis chapter 1. See, there's rhyme and reason for everything that God did in chapter 1, and there's rhyme and reason for everything that God does and allows to happen in our lives. That means that God is a God of purpose. That means for my existence today, even though you may not think much of it, even though other people may not think much of your existence, God has a purpose for your life today. You're not just some blob and here by chance and circumstance. You are here by divine design and purpose. You say, well, you don't know about the circumstances of my birth and my upbringing. No, but God does, and he has a purpose for your life today. If you have breath in your body, God has a purpose for you. Amen. God has a purpose. That means every day you don't have to walk around like you're aimless. In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. People need to see what happens when people just become thankful. God has a purpose for you. Not only does God have a purpose for you, but God has a purpose for your problems today. You say, well, I don't like them. And what's the purpose for my problem? I have no idea. All I know is this. God has a purpose. Maybe he just wants you to know that he's able to, big enough to handle it. Maybe he just wants you to realize that because you've talked pretty good for a while about how to other people about trusting God, trusting God, trusting God. Now he's teaching you how to trust God. I have no idea what the purpose is. But we know all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. Maybe God is allowing us to go through difficulties today because there's somebody that he wants us to rub elbows with that we would not normally, under good circumstances, have come across, but this problem has presented to us for looking for solutions, and so it brings us into contact with other people so that we might show them and share with them the love of Jesus Christ. God has a purpose. My friends, God even has a purpose for COVID-19. You say, well, what is it? I have no idea. Maybe it's just to keep us humble. Maybe it's to remind us how much we need one another. Maybe it's to prepare the way for his second coming. I have no idea. But God has a purpose. My God is powerful. My God has a purpose. Purpose for me, purpose for you. Purpose for our problems, whatever the situation may be, my God has purpose. So today, as I started thinking to myself, I began thinking and thanking God that he is a powerful God and that he's a purposeful God. I want you to turn over to Genesis chapter 6. Actually, I want you to go over Genesis chapter 5. Genesis chapter 5, we have a lineage. Now, we know that in Genesis chapter 3, sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death has passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. And so the perfect creation that God made became tainted, and people began to die. But I want you to notice this, and things began to get worse. Verse 20, and all the days of Jared were 962 years, and he died. And Enoch lived 65 years and begat Methuselah, and walked with God after he begat Methuselah 300 years and begat sons and daughters. And all the days of Enoch were 365 years, and Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. By the way, Enoch is a picture of the rapture. Raptured out before the devastation. He was not, for God took him. In verse 25, and Methuselah lived 187 years and begat Lamech. And Methuselah lived after he begat Lamech 782 years and begat sons and daughters. And all the days of Methuselah were 969 years, and he died. Methuselah's name, loosely translated, means this: when I am gone, it will come. When I am gone, it will come. And Lamech lived 182 years, and begat a son, and he called his name Noah, saying, this same shall comfort us concerning our work and toil of our hands because of the ground which the Lord hath cursed. And Lamech lived after he begat Noah 595 years, and begat sons and daughters. And all the days of Lamech were 777 years, and he died. And Noah was 500 years old, and Noah begat Shem, Ham, and Japheth. And it came to pass, when men began to multiply in the face of the earth, and daughters were born unto them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were fair, and they took them wives of all which they chose. And the Lord said, my spirit shall not always strive with man, for he that also is flesh, yet his day shall be 120 years. Pause there for a second. God has been watching civilization slowly get worse and worse and worse. When Enoch named his son Methuselah, Methuselah was going to be the oldest man who would ever live, 969 years. God was going to wait 969 years, the longest length of time for one man to live, before he brought destruction upon the world. As God watched man get worse and worse, and in fact, the text tells us that only the imagination of his heart were evil continually. God was watching, and God was watching, and he was patiently waiting until you get to Genesis chapter 6, where God says, okay, you've got 120 years. Even, my friends, 120 years is a long time to wait. God gives him 100, he says, now you've got 120 years to repent. And Noah spent 120 years preaching and building an ark for his family, according to the instructions by God. But I learned from this: when he is dead, it will come. To me, I believe that was a sign of saying, God saying, okay, you've got 969 years. The year that Methuselah died, the flood happened. The math is right there in the text. Do the math. The very year that he was born to the year that he died was, in the year he died, the flood happened. Specifically, God waited. God is patient. And my friends, I want you to know, God knows our heartaches. He knows our weaknesses. He knows our troubles and distractions. But God is patient. He's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And God is a patient God. But remember also, too, his patience does have a limit. But as I think over my life and some of the things that I have done and some of the stupid things I have gotten myself involved in, I am thankful that my God is a patient God. His long suffering. He's not willing that any should perish. He doesn't want us to perish. So he is a patient God. And I am so thankful today. Turn over to Genesis chapter 8. So I started thinking how God has revealed himself to me, and I began being thankful that I have a powerful God. I began thinking that and thankful that I have a purposeful God, that I have a patient God. In Genesis chapter 8, verse 20. And Noah builded an altar, so the flood has happened. The earth has dried up. Noah builded an altar unto the Lord, and took of every clean beast and of every clean fowl, and of offered burnt offerings on the altar. And the Lord smelled a sweet savor, and the Lord said in his heart, I will not again curse the ground any more for man's sake, for the imagination of man's heart is evil from his youth. Neither will I again smite any more everything that liveth, as I have done. While the earth remaineth, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, and summer and winter, and day and night shall not cease. And God blessed Noah and his sons and said unto them, Be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. And the fear of you and of the dread of you shall be upon every beast of the earth and upon every fowl and of the air, upon that moveth upon the earth and upon all the fishes of the sea. Into your hand are they delivered. Every moving thing that liveth shall be meat for you, even as a green herb have I given unto you all things. But flesh with the life thereof, which is in the blood thereof, shall ye not eat. And surely your blood of your lives will I require. At the hand of every beast will I require it. And at the hand of man and at the hand of every man's brother will I require the life of man. Whoso sheddeth man's blood shall by man's blood be shed. For the image of God made he man. And you, be ye fruitful and multiply. Bring forth abundantly in the earth and multiply therein. And God spake unto Noah and to his sons with him, saying, And behold, I establish my covenant with you and with your seed after you, and with every living creature that is with you, of the fowl, of the cattle, of every beast of the earth with you, from all that go out from the ark to every beast of the earth. And I will establish my covenant with you. Neither shall all flesh be cut off any more by the waters of a flood. Neither shall there be any more be a flood to destroy the earth. And God said, This is the token of the covenant which I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for perpetual generations. I do set my bow in the cloud, and it shall be for token of a covenant between me and the earth. Every time you see a rainbow, you can be reminded that God promised that he would never again destroy the earth with a flood. My friends, I take from that, God is a promise-making God. He promises. And he's faithful to his promises. And I'm so thankful that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, Romans 10:9, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart, Romans 10:10 says, for with the heart man believes unto righteousness. With the mouth confession is made known unto salvation. And then verse 13 says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And God does not make a promise he does not intend to keep. Our God, I'm thankful that my God is a promise-making and promise-keeping God, and he's faithful to his word. And here it's been almost 6,000 years, not quite 6,000 years, but almost 6,000 years since that promise has been made. I know everybody's worried about the flooding, the polar ice caps melting and flooding the earth again. I'm not, because God gave a promise that he'll never destroy the earth with a flood again. It's not going to happen. Now, mind you, there's some other things that are going to happen, but we'll save that for the book of Revelation. But he promised he will never again destroy the earth with a flood. It's not going to happen because God has promised in his word, and he's faithful to his word. He's a promise maker, and he's a promise keeper. Turn over to Genesis chapter 15. Abraham, to give a little bit of a context, Abraham and a band of 318 servants in his household has just pursued five kingdoms, and humiliated them on the battlefield. And now I imagine if, once you defeat five kingdoms with 318 men, you're always looking over your shoulder for when they're going to come back and get vengeance. And God tells to Abraham, he says, after these things, the word of the Lord came unto Abram in a vision, saying, Fear not, Abram, I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward. I'm thankful today that not only do I have a powerful God, a purposeful God, a patient God, a promise-making and a promise-keeping God, but I'm thankful today that I have a protecting God. I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward. Abraham, don't you worry about those fellas. I'm going to look after you. Now, that doesn't mean you live foolishly. But, my friends, that means I don't have to be afraid. My God is an ever-present help in time of trouble. What do I have to be afraid of? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or trouble separate me from the love of God? No, I'm in his hands. He's going to look after me. He will protect me. I am sealed if I know Jesus Christ is my personal Savior. I am sealed until the day of redemption. We're just about running out of time. My God is a powerful God I'm thankful for. is a purposeful God, is a patient God, is a promise-making and a promise-keeping God, is a protector. But remember in Genesis chapter 22 where Abraham offered up his son Isaac and God provided a lamb. And then he called the name of the place Jehovah Jireh. My God will provide. Jehovah will provide. I'm thankful that my God is a provider. In Philippians 4:19, the Apostle Paul said this, my God shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. My God is a provider. My God is a punisher of evil. Genesis 18:20-33. But I want to finish off with the last point. So my God is powerful, purposeful, patient, promise maker, promise keeping. He's a protector. He's a provider. He's a punisher of sin and evil. But my God is a peacekeeper. My God is a peacemaker. You see, when man chose to sin, he became the enemy of God. But God provided a way for us to make peace with him. And I want to finish off with this verse. Romans 5:1 says this, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. I'm thankful today that my God wanted to make peace with me. I'm thankful today that God wants to make peace with you today. And if you'll come on his terms, be guaranteed a place in heaven. Lord, if there's somebody listening to this program today, or maybe they're here in our audience, and they've never trusted Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, help them, Lord, to see that they can have peace with you if they will but come. Even quietly in the moment of their hearts, even say it something like this, dear Lord Jesus, I'll turn from my sin, and I receive you as my Savior. I want to make peace with you today through Jesus Christ. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord, is your promise, shall be saved. Help them to call, then convince them of your promise, we pray. Lord, as thy people, we have much to give thanks for. Time does not allow for all to give thanks, but we thank you for another opportunity tonight at 6 p.m. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's end our service, our morning service, with singing just the first verse of number 430, Count Your Many Blessings. Name them one by one. Stand and sing with me, please.
When upon life's billows you are tempest-tossed, when you are discouraged, thinking all is lost, count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the
give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. His mercy endureth forever and ever. May God bless you, and happy Thanksgiving.